You know, you can really dig out your signals and then widen it out, and then, do you know what I mean? It's just levels. Wolfpack, assemble! What's going on? It's TC, and this is an unboxing and first impressions of the Rocksolid Audio Control Strip 2. Firstly, if you're new to the Wolfpack, a very warm welcome, and if you're not, welcome back. And if you find any of the information in this video useful, please smash the like button. If you're not already part of the community, part of the Wolfpack, hit that subscribe button to receive notifications every time I upload some fresh new information. Also, don't forget to check out my samples and presets for Serum Vital Massive FMA. Check out my t-shirts and hats. Follow my influence playlist on Spotify. Follow my Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. All the links are in the description. So, this is my first impressions and unboxing of the Rocksolid Audio Control Strip 2. It is basically a MIDI controller. It's here. It's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. So 22 infinite rotating encoders. And then you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 buttons. And it's laid out like an SSL channel strip. So let's go to the unboxing. It finally arrived. The Rocksolid controller. Just cutting open this box here. It's already split on that side. Packaging seems all right. Not too bad. Right, so they got a nice sticker on here. Let's turn this around. Rocksolid Audio Control Strip 2. To be environmentally friendly as possible, all our controllers come in biodegradable packaging. No packaging pellets, styrofoam here, just one box. Now I like that. Our controllers are all hand-built and the wood is real walnut. Each one has its own character with little imperfections. We hope you enjoy using this as much as we have in designing it. I don't want to damage this, so nice. But I guess I'm gonna have to do a couple cuts on this. I'm gonna have to cut you, bruv. Let's just pull this out. A very sharp knife here. Probably shouldn't be using my new birthday cooking knives to do this. This is nice, isn't it? Look at this. I'm gonna do a second little cut on the top here. Bruv. I'm excited. Oh no, you ripped it. Right, let's have a look. It does look pretty well packaged actually. Oh, I can feel the buttons. It's a lot of packaging. Let's get rid of this box. All right, first impressions. Oh, to be fair, from my very, very first impression, okay, some of the buttons are clicky, some of them ain't. Interesting. Okay, it's got a nice feel to it, you know? Yeah, you know what? I think that's pretty cool. That's not too shabby.
So let me give you a little bit of backstory about how I found this product and my experience with dealing with Rocksolid Audio. I was on one of my usual YouTube production rabbit hole deep dives into music production, and I saw the control strip and I instantly knew that I needed to try this product, because you know, I've been dreaming about making something along these lines where you can just have a channel strip which is linked to plugins directly on each channel. And I'll go into a little bit more on how I've connected it to my different digital audio workstations, but when I saw it being used, I was like, okay, this is potentially a game-changing piece of equipment. So I went on the website, Rocksolid Audio website, and they were sold out. And I was like, oh, have I like missed out on a legacy product? Is it no longer being made? So I just flung off a little email to the info email address, and I got a reply within 20 minutes at 11 o'clock at night from a guy called Matthew, who was the director there. Their emails and communication was amazing. He told me they were going to come back in stock. There was going to be another 50 available. He told me an exact time and date that I could place my order. So I placed my order and we had those big storms, but I think usually it would be next day delivery, but because of the big storms it took 2 or 3 days to come through. So when you first plug in the unit, it connects up the top here with a USB connection, and you have to download their software, which is called Control Hub. And Control Hub looks like this. You've got MIDI settings, mouse settings. Now when it came to the way that I found it works best for me, I'm using just the MIDI. I tried this mouse stuff. With the mouse stuff, what happens is they have pre-mapped plugins. So I tried out the, what did I try out? I tried out the Logic Pro channel EQ, but I found with the mouse settings, when the controller takes over the mouse, that it wasn't very accurate. And when you let go of the control, it would kind of forget where you were. And I really wanted to have something that was a lot more rock solid. So I tried out all of this mouse stuff and I thought it's a novel idea and I get it. But for me, where the power of this controller really lies is in the MIDI side of things. So I've set it up so that the controls are just incremental from 0 to 41, and that's all the control knobs here, the buttons under the control knobs, and also the separate buttons on their own, and they're all mapped to different MIDI CC controllers. So you can't output notes with the buttons, but that's okay because most things can handle the CC controllers. So I've really used just MIDI mapping in this example. I might do another video about the mouse thing, but I wasn't convinced by the accuracy. Like, you would touch a control and you would turn it and it wouldn't do anything for like the first 2 times that you touched it, and that's not really how I want to roll in the studio. I need to just grab something and make it happen. So what I've got here is Logic, and this is just a Logic project with nothing going on, and I've only really mapped maybe 4 or 5 plugins so far to this controller. I want to be quite careful. I want it to be plugins that I'm not necessarily going to use multiple instances of them in a single channel strip. I've got a channel strip here, which is the SSL-E channel strip from Plugin Alliance. Really love this channel strip. I think it's sick. If I just show you what I've got going on, if I mess with some of these controls, like the top end here, do it with this hand so you can see. When I turn it, it turns on the screen. I mean, it's just so perfect and like really intuitive, really quick. If I play a bit of white noise, you'll be able to hear. You know, you can really dig out your signals and then widen it out, and then, do you know what I mean? It's just levels, being able to do that. You can control the compression, threshold, ratio, release, mix there, release. Just so sick. You've got your input and your output, so you could do like your mixing stuff, like mixing channels. So sick. You can flip the phase. High pass and low pass. I don't think I've mapped the gate, but I don't really use gates, so I've put these controls onto other controls. So I haven't actually mapped those yet on the expander. But yeah, you get the idea. It's a really, really super quick way of just having a channel strip in your door and just on each channel. Now, if I go to the next channel, I load up the console and I do the same kind of stuff. So I'll just do a little bit of a tweak here and there, and I'll just, you know, add some top end to it and do that, and you change the shelf on it to a bell or whatever, like just do some little EQ things. So you can just jump from channel to channel, and you don't even have to have the plugin loaded up. Like, you don't have to see them. You can just be on that channel, change the top end to full, and then open it, and it's done it. So it's literally, you're just gonna be listening and doing the thing for the mix downs. So sick, so sick. I'm not sure what other plugins I have mapped over to this. I think I have the Waves, here we go, Omnichannel. The only problem is, if you've mapped 2 multiple controls over to one thing, they're both gonna do the thing. So I have to choose quite carefully which plugin I'm gonna be using on each channel. So I'm choosing plugins that I'm not necessarily gonna have 2 two instances of it. I was trying it with Pro-Q. I really liked it with Pro-Q, but I like to have multiple copies of Pro-Q on each channel, so it's just not going to work in that instance. But if it's for like blending and just getting a mix nice and tight, just those intuitive touches where I'm just like, oh, this needs a little bit more bass, you can just go and you can just add a little touch more bass. You know what I mean? Just like, it's just right there. You've got buttons to change things, like change the shape of the bottom there, add a little bit more saturation. I've got saturation on this control here, so I can just do a bit of saturation, change the type by hitting the button. So, you know I mean, just like turn on the high pass, low pass, dial things in, input, output. It's just sick. So sick. And that works on each channel. So I haven't really had time to kind of fully integrate myself into this system, but it does seem like it's going to be a full-on game changer. So let me show you how I map controls over to the different plugins. So I'm going to load up a plugin. So I'm already using the E. Let's go for the J. So I've got my console J there. I need to load up and go to controller assignments. And what you get is this long list of assignments here. Currently, this is on E. I don't think I've got any J stuff going on. I've done the snap heap and I've done the omni channel. So I've only really mapped over like three things so far. So what you do to map a new plugin is you click on learn mode here. Then you click on the parameter that you want to change. So it's going to be high frequency. And then you grab the controller and you turn it right and then left, and it will automatically sense that it's using that specific kind of control. And if it doesn't, you just have to change it here to two compliant. It's got to be in relative two compliant. There we go. So that's it there. That is now mapped. So it needs to be in relative mode and two compliant. So let's map another control. So again, it needs to be in relative mode, two compliant. So, you know, it's quite fiddly, but once you get it sort of locked, it's going to change your workflow. So it's as easy as that. You just go through, you map all the things, and every time you load that plugin, all those controls are automatically mapped onto the Rocksolid Audio. So let's take a look at Ableton now and how I've implemented the controls for Ableton and how I've implemented the Rocksolid Audio control strip into this door. So I'm using a plugin for Ableton, which is a controller plugin called STC, Single Track Control. And you have to edit the scripting for STC so that it knows which controls you want Ableton to react to. So you go to a website and download STC. So I'll put a link in the description to the website that you got to go to download this software. It looks like this. I had to get the beta version for Live 11. And the way that you install it is that you go to your applications folder, you click on Ableton Live 11, show package contents, and then you go to MIDI remote scripts and you copy it into there, into MIDI remote scripts. And then you can edit the settings text file, which I've already got open. And I mean, it is a bit codey and a little bit sort of finicky. And if you change anything too much or you make a mistake, it actually will just not load into Ableton. I've used these because it's all written in Python. So I've used these hash symbols here on everything that I'm not using. So I'm telling the compiler not to compile those bits. So I'm using volume, reset volume, and I am using device parameters. And I'll show you what that does here. So STC stands for single track control. So whatever track you're on, which is selected, which you can't really see, let me move this over here for a second. So for whichever track that you're on, it will control the parameters on that track. So let's say here I've got a drum rack, and because I have set it up for my parameters here, these eight controls now do the macros for the drum rack, or whatever has this little blue hand, now I can control the macro controls for that, which is super game changer, right? Because you can map that to loads of different things, and then just having those controls at your fingertips straight away is just super awesome. I've also mapped the main volume for that channel. It's hard to point it out, but you can see over here for each channel, the main volume is now on this output control. So I can do, you know, mixing down. I've also changed it so these buttons make you go up and down. down, and also focus and the browser on the left hand side are now buttons as well. There's a lot more stuff that can be done in STC, but I'm just implementing functions as I think they should be implemented. You know, like, I don't want to go mad and have loads of stuff that I don't know what it does anymore. I want to make sure that every single parameter that I add to my control setup really makes sense in terms of my workflow. So if you found anything in this video interesting or informative, please smash the like button. Don't forget to hit subscribe, hit the bell for notifications so you can keep up to date with all that's new from me. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. If you have any ideas for future videos, I read all your comments. Don't forget to join the Discord server. Check the links for my samples and presets in the description. A massive big up to all the Wolfpack, and thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Peace. 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 Peace.